about this foundation. And it truly is my honor to introduce to you Senior Airman Brian Kolfage. Kolfage. Brian, come on up. I believe has a great story to tell, and certainly as you listen and watch today, consider the hurdles and difficulties that you have in your own life and ask, how can you overcome it? Because Brian has certainly done that, and we certainly appreciate your service to our country as well. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you. guys for having me, you know, in your beautiful school and taking on such a great cause, because the Fisher House Foundation is a very important thing for veterans and new veterans, and I appreciate you guys' support, so thank you guys. I guess we can all give you guys a round of hands as well. So. I'm probably just like you guys, you know, in high school, except I grew up in Hawaii and had a really fun time. And it was kind of hard to go to school, and you know, you live in Hawaii, you're like, ah, should I go to school or go to the beach? And I always went to the beach. The decisions you make in life, you know, you guys are all going to face adversity. And it's all about what you decide to do with those, with that adversity that you face. You know, you can go right or you can go left. There's nothing about it you're going to face something difficult in your life. If there's one thing you can get out of my story, is realize that no matter what, how hard something may seem, it seems like the world can end tomorrow. Just know that if you want to do something, you can do it. Just put your mind to it and never give up. So, let me see where that. This slide is just, you know, I grew up in Hawaii. I was hanging on the beach every day, and it was great. There was no complaints. And unfortunately, you know, I did bad in school, and I knew I needed to do something with my life. And so I thought, okay, well, maybe I need to join the military. So I took the route and looked into the Air Force, and the Air Force looked pretty cool. So yeah, I can do that. Air Force looks like an adventure. I'll sign up. And this was before 9/11, so there wasn't any war or anything like that. And the main thing, reason why I joined the military was to get my life back on track and to possibly have free tuition. And I joined in 2001. I served in Iraq twice. I deployed with the Red. We first invaded Iraq, and the second time I wasn't so lucky. It was on September 11th, 2001. Or no, sorry, 2004. And I was in the middle of Iraq, just went to Baghdad. I was on the base. I woke up in the morning early, and I was like, all right, I'm going to go work out, go to the gym. I woke up, placed my shoes on, put on my t-shirt shorts, walked out of my tent. I walked no more than 20 feet, and just a rocket landed right next to me. And, you're walking one day, you have your legs, you have everything, and all of a sudden your life has changed forever. When that rocket landed next to me, I don't remember, period, like what happened. I just know I was walking, and all of a sudden, boom, I'm on the ground. I thought I was still dreaming. I thought I was sleeping. Literally, I was sleeping 5 minutes before this happened. And I'm trying to figure out what had happened. And I tried to sit up and look at my legs, and like nothing was working. There was smoke all around. It was really chaotic. I had sand in my mouth. I still didn't know what had happened. And keep in mind, I'm on the ground, and my legs are gone. My hand is gone. Coming to the conclusion that I'm awake and something bad has happened. Maybe a minute had passed, and I walk out of my friend's come out of the tent, and I see the seriousness on his face. And I knew something was wrong, and they're scurrying to help me. And, I didn't feel any pain at the time. And then I tried to sit up and look at my legs, and my friends put their hand over my eyes so I couldn't see what was going on down there. So once they did that, I knew it was pretty bad. I was pretty upset at how it happened. I knew something really wrong. But I didn't really change at the time. There's a lot of chaos going on. I started becoming more aware. I see blood all over the place. I see blood on my friend. I see chunks of my body laying next to me. And the medics come pick me up and they take me to a surgical tent, which is right where I was stationed at in Iraq. And ultimately, they saved my life. And from that point on, I went to... From that point on, I was in a coma. I don't remember anything. They put me on a plane. They were expecting me to die. They called my family. And, you know, had a chaplain at my house. And they were busy. Flying to Germany and have my family there to see me before I died. When I was on the plane, I did better, I guess, medically than they expected. expected me to. So they flew me right to Walter Reed in Washington, D.C. When I got there, my family met me. I don't remember any of this. I was in a coma. I was in a coma for about 2 weeks, but it was just a medical-induced coma, so they didn't want me to wake up and notice, like, you know, I'm missing half my body or crap and have other issues going on. So they slowly brought me out of this coma, and I got to see my family, and I started this all blurred. And I just remember I knew my legs were gone, but when I finally became aware of what happened about 3 weeks after I was injured, I really didn't care. I didn't care that I lost my legs. I didn't care that I lost my hands, but I think it's mainly because I was so heavily medicated. But once they started weaning the medication off me, they gave me the power chair. I had to cruise around the hospital, and I saw other guys who were like myself, but they were had their limbs, but they had other issues going on with them. There's one kid I remember specifically. He had all his limbs. He looked normal, but he had a helmet on. And this guy, I say kid, he was probably like 18 or 19. He was talking to a doctor down the hallway, and he didn't know who his family members were anymore. His memory was gone. And from that point on, I realized, you know what? Yeah, I lost my legs, but I have my mind, I have my head. And I can remember who my family was. I can function, I can eat my food with my remaining hand. I can do everything. And it put things in perspective. I realized that, okay, you know, I can live my life. You know, I don't need someone there to feed me with straw every day. And from that point on, I just put what happened to me in Iraq every time and just wanted to move on. And with moving on, I wanted to get out of the hospital. I mean, you're basically living in a hospital room, and you have, you know, you're around these people who are blown up. It's horrific. It's not something you want to be living in. And for that, I set a goal to get out of that place. And to get out of that, I meant going to the Fisher House. And basically, the Fisher House is a house, like they explained earlier. It's on a military base, and all the families live in there. But it gets you out of that chaos of a hospital and all that just negative energy. So I just set that goal to get out of there. And a couple weeks later, I think probably 3 or 4 weeks later, I got out of the hospital and I stayed at that Fisher House. From there, I just felt normal again and I moved on. Fisher House allowed me to regain myself and be myself again. I learned how to do things again all over my new life. Basically, I was given a new life and that's how I looked at it. I had to learn how to do everything over, from brushing your teeth left-handed to, I mean, you name it, everything, doing everything left-handed, writing, washing, getting dressed. It's crazy. I challenge all you guys to use your opposite hand one day and try to do everything. And don't even use your right hand or your left hand, whatever hand you may be. It's difficult. And so the Fisher House gave me that opportunity and allowed me to adapt. These are some pictures of when I was in Iraq. When they were basically, they gave me my Purple Heart because they were expecting me to die. So they wanted to present me with my Purple Heart before I died. It was probably a few hours after I was injured. This is at Walter Reed once I woke up. Just the vigorous rehab they would put us through. It's almost like being in the gym 24 hours a day. But obviously, that's not enough. You could go back to Bishop House, which is constant learning how to do stuff, whether it's painting with your opposite hand, learn how to write, to get be able to be more precise using opposite hands, or learning how to walk. It was very intense. One of the things that I just saw the video, it made everything look very easy, like from learning how to do everything over again, but it was a struggle, it was hard. And it just had to put myself out there and try these new things that I was afraid of doing in a way. Like, I used to surf all the time in Hawaii and whatnot, but I thought I'd never be able to surf again. I tried it 2 summers ago. And I was
shocked that I did.
I was shocked that I didn't even surf again. And just putting yourself out there and realizing that you think you can do something and you actually try to do it, you know, you can do it. I mean, I got scuba certified too, and I was like, I never thought I'd be able to go scuba dive. I thought, if you don't go on the water, don't laugh. I just like float like a movie, and I like bob up and down, I swim in circles. So I'm one-handed, so I'm going like this, and literally going in circles. But I mean, it's difficult to do things, and something that you think you can't do, you really don't know if you can do it. So if you're not putting yourself out there to try to do something, then you really don't know. And with that, after I left Walter Reed, I came to Arizona, and I sort of worked with Harry Davis Mountain for the Air Force, doing the same job I did before, but just like the best job. And I kind of got sick of it, and I realized, okay, I'm back at where I was when I was in Hawaii, doing something that, it's kind of boring, or not really boring, but it's not something I wanted to be doing. And everyone was always like, Brian, you need to go to school, you need to go back to college. And I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life. And it was kind of like a dead end. It's like, okay, I lost my leg. I can't do half the stuff I wanted to do before, so what am I going to do? And one of my friends was going to architecture school, and I kind of just looked at his stuff, and I realized that, okay, this is pretty cool, but I'm missing my left hand. How am I supposed to draw as an architect and go to school? But I tried to do it anyway, so I signed up for architecture. I went to Pima and got all my basic classes, and then applied to U of A architecture school. I don't know if any of you guys are trying to do that, but don't even think about it. It's crazy. I'm just kidding. You'll have no life for 5 years. So the first year of architecture school, it's called pre-architecture. They only accept the top 50 students, and there's about 300 students. And I was scared. I was scared that I wasn't going to get in. I've never failed at anything. And I'm going in basically competing against these other students to get in. And I didn't know how to draw. I didn't know how to write. I could barely write my name with my left hand. And I had to teach myself every day how to draw. I would just sit at home drawing. And I pissed off my wife. Sorry. I would just be, I wouldn't be giving, time to her. But it was just another bump in the road that I conquered, and I was able to do it because I didn't want to fail at it, and I knew I could do it if I tried hard. After that first year, they do like a big pinup, and they take all your work, and they put it on a wall, and no one knows who the work belongs to. And they have faculty come around and say, okay, this is good. And they just blindly pick the top students to get in. At the end of that year, when I picked everyone, my teacher told me I was one of the top 5 students to get in. And with that, it just shows you that if you try to do something that you think you can't do, I went in there like, holy crap, is there some kids who can draw and do all this crazy stuff, and I couldn't do any of that when I started. And I couldn't write my name. And it just, it shows you, if you have the drive to do something, no matter how crazy, how far out of reach it may seem, you can do it. And you're going to face adversity in your life. And, if there's one thing, like I said earlier, to get out of this, is just know that no matter how far, how reach something may seem, just reach for that goal. Set yourself goals. If you want to be a brain surgeon, it doesn't matter what it is, you can do it. You guys have the skill to do it. You just have to want to do it. And with the Fisher House, I appreciate everything you guys are doing. There's other guys who are like me that aren't as, they haven't dealt with the adversity as well. And the Fisher House gives them the opportunity to be with their family. And it takes a lot of stress and load off their family. But their families don't have to pay for hotels, their families don't have to have any financial burden. And, some of these guys, their families are there, and their loved ones in the hospital, they're going to die. They're there for, reasons that may be very, very worse than mine. It's very important. So thank you again, and I just want to thank everyone for inviting me here. If anyone has any questions, you can ask whatever it may be out here. Nothing's too crazy. Go ahead.
We have a couple of questions. We'll try and relay the question up here. Anyone have a question?
All right.
No. Go ahead. Read your pick.
Stand up.
What job did you do? Did you fly an airplane?
No, I was No, I was a security forces recall. And basically we're the grunts of the Air Force. We do combat stuff for security for the Air Force. So after that, before I was in the Marine Corps, and I worked with the Army most of the time. Yes.
There we go. Did you hear? Are you on it?
Yeah, good. Answer the question.
You tell me.
I mean,
did you guys hear?
Yeah. No. Okay. No.
All right. So.
My job in the Air Force.
You up here? So my job in the Air Force was called security forces, and basically the combat for cops. We do all the ground security stuff in the Air Force. So whenever I deployed, I worked with the Army, I worked with the Marines, and got stuck doing horrible stuff. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. I mean, the military is a lot of fun. It's an adventure. Little less sick question for you. One day I'm visiting Hawaii. What's the best beach to go to? That's it. I mean, it depends on what you're looking for. Lion Pad is really cool. It's on Oahu. I don't know why. I'm here for that. I don't know. It really depends. I mean, they're all great. They're all great. But Lonnie has probably the
nicest. Then we'll do one more, and then Brian, would you be available afterwards?
Yeah.
If they want to come up and ask?
Sure.
How was the architecture school?
It's a lot of fun. I liked it because it wasn't a lot of book work. It was a lot of hands-on for me. our assignments were building things, so it was a lot of fun. And they have a lot of technology, laser cutters and different machinery that you could build stuff in. I think the best part about it was the technology that they have there with the 3D printing, you know, a lot of cool stuff that we got to play with. So it was more fun, it's a ton of work, and again, it's something that you have to be dedicated to do because it takes a lot of time. Like some of our assignments may take months to do. So yeah, but it was fun. It wasn't like going to like a normal class where you're sitting and listening to your teachers. So that's why it was fun.
And I would be remiss if I didn't introduce to you Brian's wife, Ashley. Service and your partnership with Brian. Thank you. So real quick, so you say, so what are we going to do at Andrada? When Andrada, we're going to do something similar to like NDA would do and the Shamrocks. We're going to be selling a flag, red, white, and blue flags, and there's space on the top to dedicate it to someone, perhaps a parent, a grandfather, a relative, or just to a service. An Army, Marine, a Navy person, Air Force, that you put up here and then your name at the bottom. We're going to sell these for $1 a piece. And being red, white, and blue, the plan is in the student council, we've talked about them making these into a U.S. flag. We'll either hang by the side over here or perhaps up here on the white wall. So this is just going to be one of the opportunities. I know Empire's looking at doing their feather activity that they do in the fall and use that. The ROTC at Cienega is going to be doing some things at the game. So each school gets to kind of do their own creative thinking. We're doing the flags here. There is going to be a competition at the end on November 10th. once we determine the school with the most money per student, there'll be a prize for that, as well as the school with the most creative fundraising idea. Well, we've ordered our flags that have flown over the Capitol that will be presented to the school. And we're working on what I hope will be a really neat way to deliver those flags. Now, to help in Rada, because that's what Grandpa Tate's all about, is that I've lined up someone in the community who said, if Dan Rada kids can raise $1,000, that person will match it with another $1,000. So, can you do it? So once again, Brian and Ashley and Ferris, thank you very much for your service and for sharing with us.